Without further ado, we will be going ahead with the panel discussion on leveraging technology and innovation, building smart cities. And we have the privilege of the smart city CEOs, commissioners, additional commissioners joining us to share the stories and innovations done in various parts of the country. And without further ado, I would like to introduce our special guest who has been in Kerala now. He's in the state of Telangana, working with the Ministry of Home Affairs, Government of India. He's a 2008 batch IAS officer, had many credits to his service as a senior IAS officer before joining as the director of census Andhra Pradesh with the Ministry of Home Affairs, Government of India. He has been serving as director for Kerala Tourism, taking the tourism with various innovative initiatives to next level. And he also headed the Thiruvananthapuram Smart City, which is the heritage capital of the state of Kerala. Last 3 years, he has been serving as the CEO for Thiruvananthapuram Smart City. And by the amazing work he has done with over 100% work tendered and which already started, I was there on the ground to witness all this. At the same time, various initiatives, also over 16 projects that comes under the Smart City Mission have been completed, taking through various initiatives, taking the rank of this Thiruvananthapuram Smart City from 90 to 19th, which is an amazing work. So without, please join me in welcoming Mr. P. Balakiran, IAS of 2008 batch. Welcome, sir, for joining us.
Well, thank you very much, Sudhir, for the wonderful introduction.
Thank you very much. I would also like to call upon a senior bureaucrat from the state of Maharashtra who has immense experience in the urban space. Glad to have you once again, Mr. Samir Unhel, Joint Commissioner, Directorate of Municipal Administration, Government of Maharashtra. Thanks for joining us, sir. We are also joined by Mr. Dr. Apoorv Sharma, who is the CEO of Silvassa Smart City Limited, a union territory. Thank you very much for joining us once again, Dr. Apoorv.
Thank you.
And also joined by Dr. Ashish Srivastava, who is the Chief Executive Officer, Dehradun Smart City Limited, and also he's the District Magistrate with the Dehradun District. Welcome. Thanks for joining us, Mr. Ashish.
Thank you.
With this, I would like to hand over the session to Mr. P. Balakir. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Sudhir. I think you're doing a great job. I think today's APAC India Digital Empowerment Meet and Awards has got to a rollicking start. I think I hope next 2 days also the interactions will continue and people will start learning more and more about nice initiatives which they are taking in their own places. Coming to today's session, as you all know, it is about leveraging technology and innovation and building smart cities. I'll throw some numbers at you. When Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, Government of India has come up with the Smart Cities Mission project, it was a big project at that time. I mean, even if I tell some numbers today, the total cost of projects in 100 smart cities all across India is 2.05 lakh crores. Until now, almost 1.8 lakh crore projects have already been tendered, roughly around 5,900 projects in all. And 47,000 crore projects have already been completed. So there is a lot of excitement in the 100 smart cities where these projects are happening. And we have got 10 wonderful CEOs today who are going to talk about various smart cities today in this panel discussion. So when the concept of smart cities have started by Government of India, there was a lot of terminology which was floating. Firstly, the people were asking, what is the smart city and why is the present city is not smart and how smart cities mission is going to convert into a smart city? Let me tell you that there is no universally singular definition of smart cities. It means various things to various people. It has got various definitions in the academic institutions in various countries. So when Government of India has come up with the Smart Cities project, they were very clear on what to do. They said that we have to completely concentrate on the core infrastructure, which make up the urban space. It has to be eco-friendly and sustainable practices have to come up. But they also introduced one new concept, which is the quality of life of citizens. So this was completely new in the sense that how the schemes were earlier conceived and how a parameter like quality of life has been introduced in the smart city. And then of course, the smart component. When people think about smart city, they think it is IT enabled or information technology enabled cities are called smart cities. It is partially true in the sense that a lot of emphasis is given on innovative and smart practices, but there is huge gamut of services which are not IT enabled per se. But today our discussion is about digital empowerment. I'll also touch about one issue when people ask about how smart cities project and how it is different from an urban municipal administration and why a new project had to come up and why 100 special purpose vehicles have to be created in 100 smart cities to do this. Firstly, the projects are not a typical government project. I mean, I've been working in government sector for almost 17 years and as an IAS officer for the last 13 years. It is not your typical in your face government project. Firstly, the proposals are not sent per se by anybody. There is a competition. It is called Smart Cities Challenge in the sense that all the cities in India had to compete among each other and had to submit proposals to the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs. And based on that, they have selected the best proposals and they have vetted. The first round and second round had around 60 smart cities. In the third round, there were 30. And the last round, a fourth round, had around 10 smart cities. So around 100 smart cities have come up through a process of competition. So there is already an ownership by the cities to get the smart city project. Secondly, these projects are not 100% central funded, in the sense that there is a concept of cooperative federalism which has been incorporated in this. 33% fund was coming from central government, but the equal amount of share was coming from state government. And remaining 33% roughly, I mean, these numbers are rough, but remaining 33% had to come from the local body themselves. And there was also a huge component of convergence of state and central government projects. And most importantly, public-private partnership has also been given emphasis in this. And then, as we rightly say, smart cities have also talked about convergence. I have hinted it before. There is nothing new in the sense of convergence as a concept before, but this has been mainstream in the smart cities mission. And most importantly, technology has been given great emphasis. There was a lot of emphasis which was given on setting up integrated command control centers, traffic and security command control centers, and coming up with innovative solutions. I remember one project in Trivandrum where we have developed a IT system which was called Smart Mosquito Density System, which we couldn't do in a typical project, but Smart Cities project has given that independence. And I want to emphasize one major thing which my other panel members will also stress upon is huge independence to the SPVs and to the state and to the smart cities to come up with their own innovation. It was not top down per se. It was completely, the projects were coming from the bottom. If you remember the Smart Cities Challenge process itself, the projects were actually come up with the huge stakeholder discussions. I remember in Trivandrum Smart City, even EVMs were used to select the projects and select the wards which had to be included in the smart cities. So those were the important things where people felt that these are our projects which have been included in the smart cities, not some project which have been pushed from top down. So that is one great thing which has been included in Smart Cities mission, where all the CEOs and their company boards could take all these projects within the major gamut of the services which have been provided by the smart cities to come up with their own innovative projects which meet the local needs per se. So I want to quickly go to the real executions of these projects. I think the wonderful projects have been done, as I have mentioned about integrated command control centers. There are smart roads which have been come up in many smart cities, and they have redefined the smart city, which people now think that these are our Indian cities are comparable to now some of the European and American cities as well. There's also stress which has been given on socio-economic inclusiveness. So there were a lot of slums which have been modified into an urban affordable housing. Anganwadis have come up, public health centers have come up, the public utilities have come up, like toilets, public toilets, public restrooms, and of course many of the new things have come up, in the sense that traffic and security has taken a huge technology turn, in the sense that all this new sensors have been taken up in traffic and securities, like not just CCTVs, red light violation detection, speed level detections, automated traffic control systems. They all come up in smart cities. And also, most importantly, sustainability and green technologies have been used, not just solar and rainwater harvesting, but many centers have been used. I think I'm very, very excited to know about the various smart cities projects which are being discussed in this session. So we'll quickly go to the speakers. I think already Sudhir Gautam has introduced them all. So we'll take up first we'll learn from that experience of Mr. Ashish Kumar Srivastav, CEO Dehradun Smart City. I think the smart cities today comprise of the metros like Chennai, and also we have got Dehradun is very close to all IAS officers. So Ashish is, I believe, is doing a great job there. We are very excited to know about your initiatives, Ashish. So please tell us how technology interventions have been used to make the lives of people better. Ashish, over to you.
Thank you, sir. Dehradun Smart City is basically the third round smart city, as told by the moderator of the session. The smart cities were selected in many phases. And earlier, Dehradun was participated in all rounds, but the third round it got success. And after that, almost 4 years have passed. Now, I just want to summarize entire smart city journey in two phases for Dehradun. First is pre-COVID era, and the second is the post-COVID era, during the COVID, what smart cities are doing. Most of the smart cities have done wonderful work in COVID situation. Once we started our smart city mission, so most of the things were around integrated command and control center, the traffic management, the red light violations, the speed violation, the crime detection, as well as the major infrastructures like road, green buildings, water interventions and all. So I just want to discuss two important things related to this one in brief, and then I will go to the COVID related issues what we are doing. So the one very important thing we have done here in the smart city mission is the holistic water management. Because most of the time we generally listen that the next war will be on water and this and that, but the water is one of the most neglected area, and the technology use of technology was quite less in this sector. So we decided to go and we decided to do some interventions related to water at community level, at city level, as well as at household level. So at three levels, we are doing interventions, means the holistic water management, and that things basically include, if we tell that at city level, what we are doing, we are going for a very innovative model, which is a ESCO model related with the water SCADA. So most of the time, the cities are basically going for energy efficient models for the pumping of water. As well as the second thing is that they are doing SCADA separately. So here, instead of spending almost 85 crore rupees on this, we are actually doing these two interventions in 30 crore rupees, because the private partner who is coming here for energy efficiency is the private one, and the all SCADA level interventions are done by the smart city budget. So that is one thing we are doing, so that the energy efficiency should be there, which is something like an environment related initiative, as well as we are actually measuring the water loss, which we really call non-revenue water with the help of National Institute of Hydrology. So one intervention at the city level, and at the community level, basically we are doing like at the very important places that we are having water ATMs dispensing a 300 ml water in 1 rupee. So like hospitals, bus station, railway station, and other public places, the market area and all. And at individual level, we are having the water metering. So now Dehradun is coming up with a dynamic water metering system. So all three interventions basically will save we are anticipating 3.5 crore liter of water in a year. So that is a very big achievement for a smart city mission. We can say that we are able to do this. And the second important intervention I just want to say is the our electric buses, like which is also that and that is basically very satisfying experience when you see a labor is sitting in a air conditioned but spending 10 rupees what he was spending for in Vikram or in earlier city buses. And that is very satisfying experience, and that has the technology, the electric bus has technology. When the bus is coming, what will be the fare, what is the current position, then the entire bus route is monitored through command and control center, and the safety issues related to women and everything. Though the crime is very less in Uttarakhand, but even that is one thing which I wanted to share, that these two things, how the livelihood and how the water sector is benefited through smart city and using the technology, what interventions we can do. And this time the Dehradun Smart City Limited Water Project has got basically the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, India Smart City Award, Water Project Award. So that is one thing I wanted. And in the post-COVID, what has been changed, I just want, because earlier in smart city, what was happening, like road, smart road, smart building, two big infrastructure interventions. But after onset of COVID, we have to think about smart health and smart education. Because from last 1.5 years, schools are closed. The hospitals are overburdened during COVID waves. So that thing we have actually changed, and three of the schools of Dehradun are made smart school, and those smart schools are basically teaching the government government school students through online classes and all. So that is one thing. And the second thing is that how the Dehradun Smart City has actually helped entire state in managing COVID affair, like our command and control center is managing entry and exit in the entire state of Uttarakhand. So whenever you are coming to Uttarakhand, you have to register on the smart, you have to register on Smart City portal, from where you are coming, where you are going, what time you will come, and when you are going to leave the state, so that we can do the contact tracing and all if someone is found positive. So one thing we have done, and the second thing, it was the biggest problem for everyone during the COVID time, the family were actually complaining that the doctors are not actually looking after the patient. So that we have done through the command and control center and AI enabled cameras, so that when doctor is entering in the ICU ward or the COVID ward, when they are coming out, so all those things we have managed. And we also tracked people who are coming to Dehradun and those who are found positive and are in home isolation, how we can monitor the home isolation, whether they are violating it or not. So all these things actually were done using a smart city infrastructure and through the technology. So all these four things I wanted to discuss. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ashish. It was wonderful to know about your initiatives in CEO Dehradun Smart City. I think ICCC, as you said, has played a great role during this COVID period as well, which was not originally planned, but I think nothing serves like technology. So next we'll go to Mr. Samir Unhale, Joint Commissioner, Director of Municipal Administration, Government of Maharashtra. Samirji, I think you would want to know about your experiences in the Municipal Administration of Maharashtra and how many smart cities are there. And how is it that you do the overall monitoring of various smart cities which are in Maharashtra, and how do you encourage them to carry out innovative measures? And if there are any innovative measures using technology, we'd love to hear from you. Over to you, Samirji.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. In Maharashtra, as we know, it's one of the most urbanized state in India, and the absolute urban population is more than 5.5 crores. We have around 398 urban habitats, out of which 27 are the larger urban areas, which are the municipal corporations, and 372 are the smaller urban areas, which are the smaller municipalities. Regarding the smart cities, we are currently having Mumbai. In Mumbai metro region, we have Thane and Navi Mumbai Municipal Corporation as the smart cities. In Pune metro region, we are having Pune and Pimpri Chinchwad. Another two divisional headquarters, which is Aurangabad and Nagpur, Aurangabad and Nasik. And of course, Nagpur is the second capital of the state, which is in the smart cities mission. So I think one of the important aspects in, I believe, monitoring the smart cities issues is that the principal secretary himself is the mission director for the smart cities, and therefore the highest office of the Department Ministry is directly looking on the functioning and operations of the smart city. Having said this, and as was shared by even you and our esteemed senior from Dehradun, that the COVID era has really given a tremendous push for the adoption of technology, rather accelerated adoption of technology into the municipal sector. All said and done, the Indian cities or the Indian urban system is being traditionally looked out mostly by the municipalities in the administration part or providing the civic services part, and by the land use planning, which is the mostly town planning or the other development activities. So I think in this backdrop, the basic concept or the philosophy of having a special purpose vehicle as another entry into managing Indian cities, I think has been a very major contribution of the smart city mission in India. Secondly, I think the special purpose vehicle gives an opportunity to various other actors in the city and in the state to be a part of managing the city affairs. For example, a smart city SPV can always have the police commissioner as the director of one of the directors of the SPV. It can also include other important players into the SPVs. And I think this platform of having a cross-sectoral representation into the board of directors of SPV, I think also is an important contribution of the mission, and would definitely help to make the managing of the cities much more scientific and much more, you know, professional, because the magnitude of problems that we are facing are what they are. And I believe the traditional way on traditional approach of clerical approach or sending letters is something which is not going to function. So I think this was the brief importance I felt of the smart city mission and the SPV, which are contributing positively to handling Indian cities together. In Maharashtra, so there are two different, I think, good projects which were done. Mm-hmm. One to receive the Best Governance Award just a couple of days back, which was the Digi Thane project, which was done when I was earlier working as the CEO for the smart city Thane. And it was quite important and a major step which was taken was to focus on the citizen, because many a times the projects that we focus are the infrastructure projects, but citizen is somewhere not a part, essentially a part or a focus of that. So what we really did was to make the citizen the focus of this entire activity, and to facilitate the citizen digitally to experience his city, to make his living in the city as convenient as possible. And as was pointed out in this earlier, that COVID times, this citizen app, or that is digital ecosystem, did help tremendously. In fact, Thane, that time, Thane is a city of around 2.5 million, or maybe 5 lakh families. And there are around 3 lakh registered users in the app. And various citizen to citizen, business to citizen, government to citizen, government to business to business transactions will be, you know, made a part of that. So I think engaging with the citizen directly with his mobile, considering including these aspects of, you know, even digital divide or inclusiveness, I think was an important lesson or a project that could be implemented in the city. And as of course, as was mentioned earlier, that the most of the cities, smart cities here, have taken recourse to the electric mobility. I mean, the e-buses under the flame scheme. In fact, Pune have taken over 150 electric buses. Nasik has taken over 50 electric buses. And so the urban mobility element and aspect of the cities, which is an important or rather a rather crucial pain point on from the side of the citizens, when the citizen is trying to live in a city, the way what he perceives of his city are the essential, you know, bottlenecks that come to his mind first rather than the conveniences. And mobility is the most important, you know, pain point there. Therefore, a focus through mobility on making a citizen more, you know, it's easy for a citizen to commute in the city was also done by a way of, you know, an integrated app in which the citizens could know the connect with their public transport system in much convenient way. So they don't have to wait endlessly and their bus stop not knowing when the bus is going to come. So that one, but in fact, we had installed there's a separate command control also for the city bus in Thane and also in Pune. Along with that, there is a citizen app which tells a person at which location, which bus is going to come, at what time interval, and when it is going to go. So I think the one of the key lessons that we can learn from smart cities is that it has to be the citizen which has to be the main focus of the entire activity. And all the technology and all the infrastructure powers that we have has to make the life of the citizen say livable and also lovable. So these were the small experiences I thought I would share in the first round of the discussion. So thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Samir Mahaleji. I think it was wonderful knowing overall state level perspective. Because we have been getting the city level perspectives, but it's always good to know. I think you have already worked in Thane city as well. So we get the best of both worlds. I think now we'll go to Dr. Apurva Sharma, CEO Silvassa Smart City Limited. Dr. Apurva, it would be great if you could tell us the UT implementation, what are the issues in implementing smart city projects in a union territory like Silvassa, and what are the innovations which you have done using technology, and if have you used it in e-governance projects or have you used technology in socio-economic inclusive projects? We'd love to know your perspective. Over to you, Dr. Apurva.
Good evening, sir. So basically, being a union territory, our governance and our structure of working is a bit different from what it is in the rest of the country. For example, we don't have funds that come through the urban local body, and our funds primarily come 50% from the union territory administration, and the rest 50% comes from the government of India. As on date, the situation as it stands, we have more funds that we have received from the UT administration than we have received from the government of India. So that is the most important difference that we have with respect to the funding pattern of the UT administration and the smart city mission in the union territory. Further, when we talk about the flexibility that everybody has pointed out, yes, that is the rest of the aspects of smart city mission remain the same. With respect to what we have done and where we stand, where we have used technology, so we are basically a fourth round city. And being a fourth round city, a lot of our projects were still they had not been tendered out. They had not been put to, work order had not been issued. So before COVID came, we were primarily focusing on getting as many projects as we can on the ground. But during COVID, our special interventions were basically, since we did not have a command and control center and we didn't have any technology partner on board. So we had to basically build up something very cost effective in a very short period of time with whatever resources we had. So we onboarded our local people over here, and we built a application on the Google Sheets itself, which was basically our incident management system, where we were able to track how many people were coming in, how many complaints had come in, who all were required to be provided food, and whether they had all earlier also asked for food, where our vehicles are. All those things were being monitored through the incident command system that we had developed on Google Sheets. That was a cost effective project that we had developed, and it had also been selected as shortlisted during the Smart City Awards, but unfortunately we did not get the award. So that was one very cost-effective, frugal innovation that we had done. Apart from that, we had developed a Corona Tracer application. So it was developed before the Government of India's application was developed. So we could, in that application, again monitor who was within his home quarantine, who was not following home quarantine, and whether they had symptoms, whether they were with a valid permission or not. So what we noticed was that the permissions that we issue and those that are getting printed, so there is an issue with the printed permission because they can be reused multiple times. So we developed that we will have the permission only on the application and you cannot print it out. So the person had to use the phone for the permission, entry permission during COVID. But then it was excluding certain sections of the society who did not have smartphones. So thereafter, we developed a part of the application for the enforcement agencies at the field level. So at all our checkposts, the entry exit was being monitored through the mobile phone application that the police people had. And so if one particular permission has been used for entry into the territory once, it cannot be reused. And if a person has used it for a short period of entry, for example, if it is a short-term entry, then that person should exit. And if he did not exit, there were alerts. So the application not only generated a lot of data, but also threw up alerts for us to look at and to track people and get stuff done. The application also enabled digital monitoring, and basically when our teams in the field, when they were going house to house, checking for symptoms, checking for people who were not well, but were not coming to the hospitals, all those data entry was to be done in the application. So that way we were able to monitor whether our teams were actually going out in the field, whether they were doing the surveys, so geotag locations of those things were coming. So that streamlined a lot of procedures that we had in our territory. This was, and the unique thing about Silvassa Smart City and in a union territory, what happens is when Smart City takes up a project, it does not take it up only for the city. It by default goes for the entire territory. So what Silvassa Smart City was doing was covering the entire Dadra Nagar Haveli district. So we were able to cater to much more, to a much larger population as compared to what our urban population suggests. Apart from this, we've also, during the last 1 year or so, we have like Dehradun, like Pune, we have also launched electric buses. But there's a difference between what the other cities are doing and what we are doing, because we have phased out all our diesel buses. We are 100% electric mobility. We don't have any diesel buses in our district. So although our numbers are small, but we are the only city, I believe, a district that does not have any diesel driven public transport in the district. So we are providing cost effective air-conditioned electric buses to the citizens. Apart from this, one important innovation that we did was with respect to cycling transportation. And when we talk about sustainable transportation, it is often talk about electric mobility, but cycling forms an important piece of the puzzle that is the sustainable mobility. So as per surveys, almost even today, 40% of the transportation that takes place in India is on cycles. So, and the public transport and your private transport is still a smaller number. Urban areas, urban agglomerations, it is a little different, but still a large chunk. There are two group of people whom we are targeting for public bicycle. We are not calling it sharing, because sharing does not serve purpose in cities like ours. Ours is a very small city. The area is 17 square kilometer. You can understand 4x4. It's a sort of a square type of a geography, 4x4 kilometers. So 16, around 17 square kilometers of area. So if anybody wants to cycle, he can cycle from one end to the other end of the city within 10 minutes or so. So public bike cycle sharing does not make sense in our city because we don't have first mile, last mile connectivity. The first mile and last mile are usually walkable. So we had to think about something else. So we are going for public bike leasing. So Smart City will purchase the bicycles and we'll lease them off to the citizens who want to use it. Public bike sharing in our city would have been utilized more or less by the tourists. So we wanted to do something for the local citizens. So we are going to buy bicycles and we're going to lease them to the citizens. A pilot project has been done in this regard by the Smart City and it has been found to be very successful. People have increased the number of, they're cycling more often, they're doing it more cost effectively, and it is not putting a burden on the citizens. There are two group of people whom we are targeting with this particular intervention. That is, one is students and the other is laborers. These are two huge chunk of people, chunk of population that we can shift to cycles if we are able to target them properly. So the idea is to shift these two modes of two group of people to cycles. Apart from this, we have been conducting a lot of cycle friendly initiatives. Because of Corona, we could not ask people to come to a single location. So we have our own Fit Silvassa application on which you can log your kilometers. As and as you go and log more kilometers, you get discounts at various shops. So there are 110 shops in a small city that have, declared themselves as cycle friendly. So these shops offer you 5% discount if you come on a cycle, over and above whatever discount is available in the shops. So, and the more number of miles that you gather, you will get more reward points, and those reward points can be exchanged for, discounts across these shops. So that is our attempt to bring about more and more of a cycling and a sustainable mobility culture in the city. Apart from this, we are using technology for monitoring the cleanliness of our toilets. So Internet of Things, we have installed these sensors in our toilets which tell us what is the odor level. Not only us, but any citizen can get onto that application and can figure out what is the cleanliness level of the toilet at what point. So we get to know which toilet is being cleaned, how often and how clean is it during the day. What is the time when we should ask our people to go and clean these toilets? So these are the things that we have done using our technology. We have also, Smart City has not just executed projects on its own, but also has assisted other departments in technically improving their solutions. So the police department, it went for e-beat project. So that is basically, it is a paperless beat project. So they enter wherever they go, they enter the details in their beat book. Now they are entering it in their application. So Smart City was the technology partner in that. So we helped redefine and improve the tender process and the tender documents and implementation of the project. So that was one more thing that we did. We are also looking at using drones for a variety of projects. That is at concept stage. That project is still at concept stage, but the board has approved this project. So we are looking forward to deploying the drones for certain activities like survey, your encroachment removal, your property tax assessment, and all those things. Apart from this, we are also funding the smart classroom project. All the classrooms in the urban area will be made smart classrooms through the smart cities. So these are the major projects that we are doing in Silvassa Smart City using technology, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Apurva. I think it is wonderful knowing the perspective of Silvassa Smart City. So when we go to Europe, say in Copenhagen or Amsterdam, they pride themselves that there are cyclists everywhere. I think they are one of the fittest people as well. And I'm very happy to know that Silvassa is implementing that initiative. Bicycle sharing was the project which was originally part of Smart City's mission, but I think you have gone one step ahead. I really like the discounts in the shoplets when you cycle certain kilometers. I think that is really one good way of increasing physical fitness and also reducing hydrocarbon pollution. Thank you, Dr. Apurva. I think now we'll go to from a small city of Silvassa to the mega metro Chennai. Raj Cherubal, sir, is I think the CEO of Chennai Smart City. I think it has, Chennai, I have personal very good memories because I have done my IIT graduation there, and I always Chennai brings out the best of the memories in my thing. So Chennai, we would want to know a couple of things, Shri Raj. One is because Chennai is such a big city, and the ABD component is generally limited to a particular section of the city. So how do you do it? Do you do retrofitting of the existing projects, and how smart city as a concept comes in and fits in this huge jigsaw of activities which are happening in the Chennai Municipal Corporation? And secondly, we'd also want to know, whenever you say talk about mega cities, we always talk about traffic as an issue, and how technology you are using to reduce the traffic issues, and maybe how do you tackle the problems of parking? Do you use multi-level car parkings or electromagnet puzzle parkings? We would want to know. We are very excited and heavily anticipated about the activities which you are doing in Chennai Smart City. Over to you, Shri Raj.
Thank you so much, and it's wonderful to hear CEO of other cities, Dehradun, Silvassa, and all talk about very interesting work that they're doing. One good thing about Smart City Mission, I must say, is that there's a lot of opportunity to learn from each other. It's not a simple silo that we do something here, they do something there. I think there's a lot of exchange, and that's something I really appreciate, because before COVID and even after COVID, using online, but before COVID, nothing like going physically visiting these places. I think I've been to Dehradun, Pune, and other places, and we learned so much, and it encourages our engineers in the corporation, because it's one thing to talk about Paris and London, but it's another thing to hear that somebody has done this in Pune or Mumbai, Delhi, and various other places. Here in Chennai, I think we've had a very exciting time in the last 4 or 5 years. A lot of changes on the ground. I think in the end, I think people want to see stuff on the ground. So I think our successes have been fantastically received. Pedestrian Plaza, which basically made a very, very important commercial district into like a open plaza almost, open mall. 210 water body restoration, and I'm very happy to say that we won an award recently. I'm very excited about that. So a lot of physical improvement, and something the others CEOs also mentioned, ultimately saving water, reducing pollution. These are the measures. I mean, no point doing technology for the sake of technology, but ultimately quality of life of citizens have to improve. But obviously, and very obviously, technology makes a huge difference. I'll quickly run through some other things we have done. So for example, as you can imagine, the car population in a city like Chennai can be pretty intimidating and very menacing. Haphazard parking, lost revenue, a lot of revenues lost. In fact, many of the cities in the world collect so much money from parking. And a fund-starved city of India like Chennai, for example, parking funds are very, very important. So we are actually implementing something, very, very sophisticated parking system, which could potentially be one of the largest in the country, if not the world, which involves a lot of technology, camera analytics, like your Google and Ola and Uber. You can use the phone to figure out where the parking is. You can pay electronically and so on. Pretty well received. I was expecting a lot of resistance, but then a lot of people find it very convenient. Also, for example, in Tinagar, right next to the pedestrian plaza, because if you think of it as a mall, you want less crowd of cars over there. You want people to park in a multi-level car park. So as we speak, it's functional, where your car is retrieved within 60 to 90 seconds when you go back and to retrieve your car. It's fully automated. First floor on, it is completely automated, no human intervention. So that is one thing. Then, for example, as the CEO Silvassa pointed out, we have a pretty good, very well-received smart bike project that's happening. Smart Bike is the company. I think they're doing this in Chandigarh, Hyderabad, Delhi, and so on. We have even introduced e-bikes, which means you use only a fraction of your energy just by pedaling. The motor kicks in and helps you go further. So we are hoping that people who, especially the little bit higher income, who are the ones who are crowding the road with cars, you know, when especially during peak hours in terms of, you know, going to IT companies and whatnot. If they could switch to cars, it'll have a dramatic impact on traffic, because even 10%, 20% of the cars, if they're removed during peak hours, pretty much the roads become free flow of traffic. So parking, cycling, and then, of course, our command and control center. Chennai, as you probably know, we've had many disasters, from floods to all kinds of disasters. And like everybody else, we've suffered COVID. So I think the command and control center, initially pre-COVID, it was more geared towards rainfall and floods and so on. So we had flood monitoring devices, pollution devices, and so on. We have a very nice command and control center, which is looks pretty like James Bond movie-like place. But the question everybody will ask ultimately, of course, what's in it for me? How does a commissioner, or how does a DC, how does an engineer, and public for that matter, life becomes better? So the idea is that there's a lot of inefficiency in the system, a lot of manual work, a lot of repetitive work. All this can be automated, and you can focus on use cases and standard operating procedures, whether it's a tree fallen somewhere, all the way to flood management, disaster relief, and so on and so forth. All this can be automated. Thereby, with limited staff, limited resources, we can deliver a much better quality of life for people. And of course, public ultimately is the beneficiary. Now we are trying to integrate all the systems like ERP systems and so on, so that public can see transparently what the projects are happening on the ground in their neighborhoods, what project is happening, where it is, and so on and so forth. Then, of course, we have a very well-received complaint management system app, where if you complain about something, people on the corporation responds very fast. And technology-wise, for example, as somebody else also pointed out, what you can't see, there's a lot of loss in electricity and loss in water, because what you can't measure, you can't manage, as the management people say. So, for example, the Metro Water people have put about 12,000 odd commercial meters, because most of the times they don't know how much this big building consumes. So smart metering for water, and as we speak, about 1.5 lakh smart meter for electricity is getting implemented. And all this has tremendous savings for those line agencies and convenience for the public. So all this, as you mentioned, is being done in the middle of a city that is about 8 to 10 million people. And the ABD area of Tinagar is actually one of the densest probably in the world. I mean, any part of India is dense. But Tinagar is super dense. And also, it's one of those commercial capitals of the world, where during festival season, marriage season, people come from all around the world to shop. So doing these projects in the middle of a city, which is, which has a lot of problems inherently, has not been easy. I don't want to make it sound very easy. Retrofitting is not easy. But I think this is something I say in many seminars. Typically, in most of these seminars, people start talking about satellite cities and, green cities and out there somewhere kind of cities. As if, because see, our Indian cities are so intimidating. When you stand in any of our cities, it's so chaotic, so messed up. It's very intimidating. So it's in our mind, it's easier to deal with a green city or a fresh work somewhere. We imagine a Singapore being planned far away in some paddy field somewhere, and not cleaning up the mess that we have right in front of our eyes. So I think smart city, that is very shrewdly have said that instead of going around putting solutions all over the city and making a mess, you take a small ABD area, do the work there, and it fully acknowledges the fact that our cities have very little capacity and a lot of issues are there. So in that sense, at least Chennai, I can speak for Chennai, we've been able to cooperate with all these different departments and tremendous cooperation from other departments to painfully implement these projects, so that public is able to finally see some change on the ground and tremendous, it's been appreciated, very well appreciated, I must say. And I'll conclude by saying one of the original thoughts of smart city has been not simply that government will give you 1,000 crores and you go do something. Idea was to emulate other advanced cities where the city has capacity to raise funds, bring in new projects and so on. I can kind of proudly say that Government of Tamil Nadu found the smart city projects pretty encouraging. So two, three things have happened. One, about 3-4 years ago, the government decided that we will implement something called the Intelligent Transportation System, which is almost a 900 crore project, which involves entire Chennai metropolitan area. But the automated signaling and so on and so forth, the very sophisticated red light violation, speed traps, something what you would see in an advanced country, is coming to about 165 junctions, so that a corridor, for example, you will be able to travel in a car or a bus or so on without stopping in, let's say, 3, 4, 5 signals, and then you will stop like you would expect in a well-managed city. Very sophisticated technology behind it, very, very complicated, very difficult for us to get a handle on it, but we have somehow managed to get to the DPR, and now any day we'll be tendering. That is one piece. The other exciting news about Chennai is that the World Bank and the Government of Tamil Nadu took notice of all this. And for the first time in India, World Bank is entering into something called the City Partnership. So Chennai is going to be part of that City Partnership, where instead of doing ETBT projects or projects in pieces, they are trying to invest huge amounts of money from World Bank and state government, build upon the successes of Chennai, not just Smart City. There have been other departments doing pretty good work. So building on all these successes and scaling it to a much larger proportions. So, for example, we have done a nice job of plaza. So the question is, can we do this in 100 kilometers, 110 kilometers, making sure that the non-motorized transport, pedestrian safety, parking, all these things you can imagine is all integrated into planning and then implementing it, so that you have ducting, you have rider sewage, etc. So you don't go dig up the roads after 2 days after laying the road and so on. What you would expect from an advanced city, and a bunch of other things to be done in Chennai. And more important than all that, some institutional changes. So, for example, forming something called the Unified Metropolitan Transport Authority. You see, it's easy for a bus company to do something, or corporation to do something, highway to do something. But as you can imagine, integrated planning among all these departments pretty much doesn't exist in any Indian city. You know, that's one of the things you'll see in Singapore, which has the Land Transport Authority, or the Transport for London in London, and so on. So based on those models, the World Bank and the Government of Tamil Nadu wants us to do some institutional changes. And then the money should flow through these institutions, so that it's based on some common plans to address common objectives. So I'll stop with a quick example. So typically in an Indian city, if there's congestion, immediately people say, whoever is owning the road, which is the corporation, for example, go put a flyover, go put an elevated road, go do road widening. An advanced city will not go that route most of the time. 90% of the time, they will say, probably we need more buses, we need more metro rail, we need more footpath, we need to do congestion charge, we need to do parking to reduce the number of cars and increase public transport, as an example. So that's an example of an integrated way of thinking of a city. I'm hoping that with all this good news, Chennai is very close to achieving all those things in the near future. So thank you so much for this opportunity.
Thank you, Shri Raj Shirpal. I think we have had a wonderful perspective of how smart cities are actually implemented in the mega cities. So I think we'll do one small round of questions, and then I think we can close the session. I think for my first question is to Shri Samir Unhale in Maharashtra. So there are many smart cities which are coming up with their own integrated command control centers. So at a state level, is there any proposal where you integrate this command control centers and maybe come up with a bigger leadership support system? And if such thing is there, we would love to hear from about that.
So actually, smart cities currently in Maharashtra are quite big one. They all are million plus cities. And they already were into IT long before the smart city mission started. So they have their own strength and capabilities. So we haven't really, you know, thought of having a state level support or state level directions to the big cities which are already doing well. What we are doing here in Maharashtra is for the smaller municipal council, the local, the smaller urban areas of population less than 3 lakh. It is for this we do create a state level platforms for them to function, instead of 350 cities having their own tenders and own issues. If those are being done centrally at state level, but it is not visually, it is not visually the command control center. But just another submission I really wanted for this audience is that, you know, the when you think of the impact of the smart city mission on India's urban system, when we think of, you know, impact of smart city mission on India's urban system, we do see a lot of opportunities and, you know, a lot of things which need to be replicated and replicated at a very fast pace. One city doing one good thing at one time is not something which is going to suffice for India's urbanization issue. So I think this methodology of, you know, of accelerated replication of best practices across India, like I think Chennai, I think Raj said that, you know, what we are, they are doing in Chennai, they are planning to do elsewhere also. I think this is an important, you know, lesson which can be learned elsewhere, so that this the experience of one city doing what good thing is gets replicated much more faster in other places. That was one submission I wanted to make. And secondly, I think Indian smart cities were supposed to be, you know, lighthouse cities. They were supposed to demonstrate what could be done earlier. But the mission cannot stop at that level. I think many state governments also, along the central ministry also, is now talking of, you know, taking the benefits to all the 4,000 cities and towns of India. And I think it's a very important part. And most importantly, I feel that the Indian municipalities, what they were, it's a 170-year-old legacy that we have, I think is reaching a point of saturation. And now there is a need either for a next round of constitutional amendments, A, or also a greater opportunity for SPVs and other private entrepreneurship, private funding to contribute to, you know, making the Indian cities more livable. I think that is, we have to, whether single, simpler projects, and are there always, they are followed up. But a broader framework of Indian urbanization and the implication of technology and the way forward, I think are, you know, important challenges that we'll have to really think of in the coming days. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Shri Samir. Dr. Apoorva, I want to point ask one question to you. So when we introduced in Trivandrum electric rickshaws and electric autos, so there was a lot of novelty in it. Of course, it has come up with a lot of excitement that electric vehicles have been first introduced in the city of Trivandrum. But there were also some problems in the sense that one, because electric mobility, electric rickshaws or electric autos, or even for that matter, electric scooters, had to be charged at regular intervals, because one charge usually gives around 60 to 70 kilometers mileage, if I may say so. So we had to quickly come up with this EV chargers at various places. So what is your experience in mainstreaming such activities in Silvassa?
Sir, with respect to this, the implementation of electric mobility in Silvassa, the most important challenge that we faced was from the auto rickshaw drivers, because in Silvassa the intercity connectivity is very poor, and intra-city being a very small size city, people usually are able, and we have mixed use. We don't have, you know, residential zones in our city. We don't have exclusive commercial zones in our city. So everything is available within 100 meters, 300 meters of your house. So we have different commercial areas in spread across the city. So what happens is the mobility that we people want is intercity. So people within the city, they either move on foot or their own personal vehicle. So the auto rickshaw drivers, what they used to do is they used to pack almost 7, 8, 10 people in their autos, and on a sharing basis they used to take them to the neighboring cities, because we are the three important cities, Silvassa, Vapi and Daman. So the connectivity between these cities is through auto rickshaws. So these people, they had a lot of issues with our electric buses, but we told them, see, you people are to provide for those who are in, you know, who have an urgent need to move to some city or some other place. So you charge them on single basis, and these when poor people are moving on a regular basis, this is something that public transport should do. So through repeated communication with them, we were able to overcome that. With respect to the electric scooters and electric autos, that has not been a success in Dadra and Nagar Haveli, Silvassa, for the reason that the the distances are very long here. You don't have that connectivity issues on shorter distances like we have in Delhi. From one metro station, you have to go to your home, you need a electric auto. That is not there over here. So by the time you walk for 100 meters, you will find some or the other bus stop, you'll find some or the other place, and you get, or you are able to reach the shopping complex or your workplace within 100 meters, 200 meters. If it is not that close, then it is usually many kilometers away. You have to travel down from the other city. So this was the issue that we were facing. But with respect to the charging infrastructure that, sir, you have pointed out, rightly pointed out, what we are giving today in our integrated road tender that we are coming about with, we are providing for electric, special dedicated spaces for electric vehicles to be parked. So electric autos will get a preference, electric vehicles will get a preference, electric two-wheelers will get a preference, and they'll get charging avenues, opportunities there. And with respect to our electric buses, we are establishing electric charging stations, not just in our city, but also in other cities. So Daman is going to have one electric charging station for our buses that are going to Daman. And one will be there in the almost the other subdivision that is there of Dadra Nagar Haveli. There will be one charging station there. So we are decentralizing the charging station so that the dead kilometers that every bus has to run is reduced. And there are no depot facilities there. The repair, maintenance, everything that whatever has to happen will happen at a centralized location. So that will also reduce our cost. So these are the ways that we are trying to manage the handicap of lesser kilometers being possible in the current technology of electric mobility, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Apurva. My next question is to Mr. Raj Cherubal. One thing which we have seen, which has generated a lot of excitement about smart cities, is the smart roads, because that is the most perceptible change which any smart city project could bring. It has generated a lot of excitement in Kochi when the smart roads have brought in a lot of interest among people. So I want to know, in a major mega city like Chennai, so if this project has been implemented, and if so, what were the difficulties in bringing all the overground utilities underground, and of course setting up pedestrian spaces which are almost nil in many of the cities. In fact, pedestrian facilities are the ones which generally people complain about.
Sure.
So how did Chennai address this matter? We would love to hear about that.
So I think I always compare a city to a cake, right? So you have multiple layers in a cake. You have to have the parking layer, the dog layer, the tree layer, the stormwater layer, park, and so on. If you don't, a great city has all those layers. Third world country cities are few layers, so literally like that. I mean, you can think of it that way. And the problem is that each of these layers is a painful layer, right? Again, imagine putting a parking management system in a city, any city on earth, and a congested city like in Chennai is near impossible because of too many variables, too many police, enforcement, corporation is into something, highway, road, they may say, no, it's my road, I won't allow you. So all kinds of combination just to do one layer. The problem is, if you don't do parking, you can't do footpath, because you do build a nice footpath, somebody goes and parks on it, the papers will write immediately saying that what kind of a fool gives footpath when you can't control parking, right? So we go round in circles fighting each other and fighting everybody else and being cynical, saying onnuma panna mudiyadhu, it's impossible, just forget it. So I think getting something done was painful. I see and everywhere, Thiruvananthapuram and everywhere else, it's been a painful affair. But the good news is that once you demonstrate something, I think people's cynicism reduces, including official cynicism comes down. Most of it, we started off with color pictures, because it's very difficult to imagine, right? When you say smart road, you imagine something, I imagine something else. And different people have different requirements. Some people say, don't give footpath, because hardly any space for cars to go. What footpath are you talking about? Or there's no parking space, so give parking, don't give footpath, don't give. So we did a lot of painful interactions with the public, and I'm sure I sympathize with the shopkeepers and so on, because imagine suddenly somebody comes and digs gigantic holes in front of your shop for months in the name of stormwater, in the name of electrical ducting, in the name of OFC cable. But all said and done, the demo, nothing like a demonstration effect. So initially, people used to say, I mean, this is the worst project ever. You're trying to destroy the whole Tinagar. Now everybody says, how come you're only doing in Tinagar? How come you're not doing in front of my house, you know, all around the city? In fact, politicians say the same thing. How come you're focusing only on Tinagar? Why can't you do it near in my constituency? Which is the, I think, the painful procedure, but the success of all our smart cities. I mean, all our cities, I'm sure. I think, and very importantly, again and again, I want to insist this, nothing like engineers and cynics going to other cities and looking at it. So, for example, Pune, I think Mr. Kunal Kumar used to be commissioner there. They did some spectacular work, right? And Bangalore has done some spectacular work. So when we used to talk about Plaza, people used to laugh at us, saying, "Allah panna mudiyadhu." When we went and saw Pune and let's say Bangalore, we came back enlightened, our engineers came back enlightened, and we were able to do it. Now, a lot of people, for example, come to Chennai and look at the plaza. And it's not simply the space, it is the operations and maintenance of it. It is the, we see, for example, it's become a cultural space. So youngsters come and play guitar and, you know, music and so on and so forth. So conclusion, I'll say, look at all this as a layer of cake. Plus, it is about for human beings to enjoy the space. Not about technology alone. From that perspective, I really thank that we've been able to do, not just in Chennai, in many other cities, and we need to multiply.
I think that was a wonderful session. I think we could learn a lot. Though I have left Smart City three months ago, I felt I'm reliving all the memories which from your experiences. I think, Sudhir, I think I'm done with my job. It's over to you. I had a wonderful time. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much, sir. We had a wonderful session. We got to hear from various states and cities of the of a country, representing, of course, through Bala, sir. We got to hear about Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala, through Mr. Raj. We got to hear about Chennai, Tamil Nadu, and about Maharashtra through Sri Samir Unhelji. And also about Dadra and Nagar Haveli, Dr. Apoorv Sharma. We got a good interaction discussion about various technologies being integrated, and also challenges were highlighted. With this, we come to the end of the session, and also the day. This is the last session of the day one of India Digital Empowerment Meet and Awards by APAC News Network. We are thankful to all the eminent speakers who have joined in the inaugural session, especially those representing Government of India, Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, Mr. Durga Shankar Mishra, Department of Science and Technology, Government of India, Professor Ashutosh Sharma from Kerala. We had Satyajit Rajanji, Dr. Neeta Verma, NIC, C.S. Kumar, Panchayat Raj, Ministry of Panchayat Raj, Government of India. At the same time, any other senior bureaucrats, policymakers have joined us from various parts of the country, including Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Karnataka, of course, Maharashtra. And also, we also had representation in this session from Uttarakhand, Dehradun. With this, we come to an end. I would like to thank each and every speaker who have joined us. We would like to call upon all the audience who have joined us today. This day one was focused on governance. Day two would be focusing on digital transformation in healthcare sector and well-being. We would be having eminent speakers from the government sector, industry, and academia to talk about various trends and technologies that are happening in healthcare sector. And the day three would be focusing on education. With this, I would like to thank each and every speaker. Mr. P. Balakiran, Raj Cherubal, Dr. Apoorva Sharma, and Mr. Samir Unhel, and of course, Mr. Ashish Srivastava.